this thing's a ute, but it's also a Winnebago, and it's a beach house, and it's got a bit of Starship Enterprise as well. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Riviera 585 SUV. This is the boat you buy instead of the beach house in Noosa or Miami or Mallorca, because this is the boat that just takes you to any beach that you want. Well, you don't even have to go to a beach, just go somewhere nice, because you've got everything on this boat. But she's 65 feet overall. She's a bit of a beast. 32 tons light ship. So can you manage this boat by yourself? Can you operate something so much bigger than your last boat? Is it going to be daunting? And who is best suited to owning and driving something like this? Welcome to the Goldie, ladies and gentlemen. We are just heading north at the moment in what is typical offshore conditions. Confused sea. We have some swell coming in from the, looks like about of a northeasterly direction. We have some breeze coming from a northwesterly direction. And I've just got the Humphrey stabilizers all on auto, as you would on this boat. And I've even got this very luxuriously leather-bound chair in full forward. They've accommodated people with little legs like myself, so that's just wonderful. In this test, we're going to take this boat on all points. So we're just currently maintaining somewhat into the swell. I'm going to start turning through those waves in a second, and I'm just going to maintain a sensible speed whilst we're out here. And then later on in the video, when we get inshore, we will start to wind the boat right up to full throttle, just because it'll be flatter water and we can give you a more accurate demonstration of what the boat can do. So just putting her through a starboard turn right now. This is just comfortable stuff, guys. You know, I really do feel like the captain of the Starship Enterprise here. I can operate my windscreen wipers just here. I could have the boat on autopilot. My visibility all around is absolutely epic. And even in these confused seas, I'm comfortable. So now we're taking the swell on the port beam. And let's speed the boat up a little bit, but not too much. And so just if you look through the cameras and look at the horizon and see how stable that is, guys. Next thing I want you to do, oh, there's whales just jumping out to port. We're clear of the whales, they're quite a way out. Just listen to the noise. It's so well insulated on this boat. It's a style of boat that you could run at speed through waves comfortably for a long period of time. I think we have a seacock open on one of the sink taps. We could easily close that. That's the only thing I could hear. So now we're going to go down. We do have an outgoing tide, so we have some very confused water going through the bar here. And what I'm going to do is just bring the speed up a little bit. So our fuel flow, total fuel flow is 200 litres. We've got an engine revs of 1700 revs, and we're getting a GPS speed of 21 knots. That's a pretty sensible speed out here in the ocean. In terms of litres per nautical mile, that's 9.4 litres per nautical mile. And the engine load, it's around about 65%. Now, if I just give it a little bit more speed, and we are about to go through some real choppy stuff in a second, so I may vary that speed. Now I'm at 1800 revs, 8.8 litres a nautical mile, and my total fuel flow sitting on 189. Oh, okay. It's varying as we go through the waves. Very confused seas right now. We have tide going out, swell coming across, chop from every direction. This is just luxurious stuff. Look at these cameras. Look at the attitude that this hull is assuming. It is flat and confident. This is confidence inspiring. So if you are new to driving in exposed waters like this, or if it's something you've considered and you on your smaller boat, but you really feel like you'd want to do it on a bigger boat, just look at this, guys. Now I'm going to increase that speed a little bit. Got the air conditioning running. It's winter here on the Goldie, but we need the air conditioning. It's that warm already. What is summer gonna be like? Okay, just bumping that speed up to a GPS of 22 and a half. We'll do 23 in a second. And sure, you can go faster in the ocean. I'm not the sort of guy to go belting boats in offshore conditions. I would really pick my times, but you do, you obviously. I can tell that this boat will do whatever you want it to do. It's more about you and your guests' capacity to withstand it. On this boat, that's not gonna be an issue. We are 65 feet LOA, 58 at the waterline, about 58 foot 11 inches from memory. So you really are skipping between wave to wave. You are quite high off the water. Your visibility, full 180 degrees and back is totally fine. And this helm, which I'm gonna talk about in more detail in the walkthrough, is really, really good. I love having these windscreen wipers right there, easy to touch. Okay, now we're out of the rough stuff. So I'm gonna start slowly increasing my speed. We will test out the zero speed stabilization at rest. I was gonna turn it off in the ocean, but it's just not the sort of day that you would do that. I figure like, if you're gonna have stabilization, use it. So that's what we've done in this demo. I'm just gonna be cutting around to the right here. My revs are coming up to 1,950 revs. Going through a stabilized turn there at 250 liters overall and 10 liters per nautical mile, giving me a GPS speed of 23. And now I'm gonna start speeding up. Got my markers on starboard, green on starboard, red on port, heading up the channel, a little bit of traffic, 27 knots, really comfortable. So 27 knots at 2150 revs, giving you a total fuel flow of 290 or 10 liters a nautical mile, feels really comfortable. She actually feels like she wants to go a little bit more. So let's just nudge that out. Yeah, feel that. 28, 30 knots. Okay, heading for the middle of the channel. Going through a little bit of boat wash. No furniture noises, by the way, except for maybe the cutlery rattling in the drawer if you haven't got it stowed properly. So the insulation, the joinery that I saw in the factory yesterday and how they put this thing together is just showing what they've achieved on this boat by being very quiet and comfortable. Okay. So I'm not gonna do wide open throttle yet because my drone can't keep up going into the wing. What we'll do, we'll get up this end of the channel, we'll turn around and then we'll blast it full speed all the way back and see what we can get. But I'm sitting at 32.9 knots and I've got 358 liters total and still 10 liters per nautical mile because of our increased speed of 33 knots. Incredibly comfortable, incredibly comfortable. You could drive this boat sitting back the whole time. You don't, oh, no need to stand up, by the way. No need whatsoever. Okay, check back in and we'll go downwind and give you the full speed experience. Okay, from a standing start, guys, I'm just going to accelerate. I always like to give it a soft acceleration on the throttle. I'm not the sort of guy to go from nothing to full floor, to flooring it, because I do believe you want to give those engines time to catch up. Just sticking to the starboard side of the channel here, straight away, already at 33, 34 and climbing knots, 100% load on the motors. The bow raise actually has been quite minimal and I'm at 37 knots and climbing. Oh my God, this thing flies. We got the 1,000 horsepowers, so that's the upgraded motors, and we are at 38 and a half knots. Oh my God, for a boat this big, we are absolutely hauling. 38 and a half knots, 353 liters total, 9.7 per nautical mile, making some waves, but I'm gonna come off the plane now because we're gonna be going into this anchorage. And look at how those waves dissipate, even with a tender on the back of the boat. So we do have a little bit of weight aft in terms of our CG, guys. Coming off the plane, no need for me to stand up. My viz is great and my waves behind me are visible even from a seating position. This is a driver's boat. This is a driver's boat. This is very, very easy to operate. So if you have come from a smaller boat and you're feeling a bit daunted, is that the right word? Anyway, if you're nervous about getting into something of this size, from that experience just then, I'm going to say don't be, but keep watching. We will go in, we'll get out of this ripping tide. There's probably might be some more tide ripping up there actually, but what we'll do is we'll test out the joystick operation and transferring to the wing station, because this is not only an ocean beast, she's also marina and dock friendly. And I just experienced that the capability of this boat to actually hold station is incredible. So keep watching. Okay, guys, change of plan. Well, I'm actually just going to anchor the boat here. And because we are pressed for time, Dean hasn't got a microphone on. He's going to anchor it. I've just undone the claw. We're just sneaking in between here whilst another boat is sailing out of the anchorage. It's kind of unusual. Do people normally sail out of the anchorage here? I'll just show you guys what we're looking at. That guy there sailing out of the anchorage. But then we're going to pick a nice location so you have a pretty background, and we're going to deploy the anchor. So all we did is I went forward and undid the claw, which is the safety on the anchor. My drone's clear of that yacht. Yep. And then we're ready to operate it from the bow. Now, I want you guys to pay attention to the design of this bow. I'm just gonna focus down on that a little bit closer. Notice how on the 585, the hull flares out to allow for, instead of having a big bow roller sticking out the front, it's part of the design. So when we deploy this anchor, we will be totally clear and free of the hull itself. So this is a little bit of just super user friendly, basically, because dropping and raising the anchor, you don't really need to worry about it swinging, is the point I'm trying to make. So we're gonna use the Muir chain counter that we have at the helm. We can also operate it from the bow if you needed to. You can see the stainless anchor going down, swivel and a gow chain. And we're gonna be anchoring in about 3 meters of water. We've got about a 1.6 below the keel. And so you could do all of this by yourself with the joystick, because of the joystick, because it allows you to station hold. We're gonna actually just demo that in the marina. We've just decided that might be a better place to show you, and we'll focus on the anchoring here. So, here we go. We can see the number of meters of chain that are going out, because we got the display at the dash, and happy days. Okay guys, slight change of plan. We are running short of time because I have an airplane to catch. So we figured we'd just film the actual parking of the vessel back at the marina and bring you guys along with us. So we're just gonna be bringing the boat in on the regular helm at the moment and then transferring to the wing station in a second. Both got microphones on, so hopefully you'll learn a thing or two. Nice and tight, this marina. I'll move the camera for you guys so you can actually see. There you go. Shallow water, a couple of meters to port. We've got quite a bit of wind on the back of that boat over there.
Now we can enter into our docking mode on the joystick. We get into close quarters maneuvering, and we can maneuver the vessel easily with this Volvo Penta joystick.
And what we learnt about this latest system is that it will just go in small increments.
Yeah, so if you have a look at the screen here, I will engage dynamic positioning system,
yep,
which also on this boat, because it's optioned, is assisted docking.
Yep.
You can see here on our screen, we've got our warnings that when we're using this option in a marina or in an anchorage or something to be mindful of swimmers, because the engines will be engaging. We've got our GPS signal here. Obviously, it's working off our, off the satellite to give us the signal. We need a strong signal.
Yep.
For it to be able to keep us on the spot that we're at. This is our little gauge, our sort of a compass rose of where the boat is positioned. And the amount of thrust, the amount of power that's applying, being applied to keep us against our elements at the moment.
Yep.
Wind, tide. The other function we have on the side here is side push function. So you can lean the joystick over and apply an amount of thrust, push the side push button at the same time, and let go of the joystick, and the engines will apply that amount of thrust and keep you against the jetty while you tie up.
Fantastic. So single man or woman operation.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Now we'll just edge forward with docking assist.
Now, by doing the little edge on the joystick, that's just taking us forward a meter at a time.
Yes, yeah, definitely. A meter at a time, keeping our same position.
So,
same heading.
Guys, it's keeping the heading. As you can see, we're just in a marina with the wind going from starboard to port, but the bow's not moving. So that's what's going on. And by these little touches forward on the joystick, it's just creeping us forward, but maintaining our position.
And when you let go of the joystick, it holds you back in that position when you let go.
There you go. So much more user friendly from back in the day when you had to use the joystick super carefully, gingerly, because it wouldn't do that. So I'm going to move these cameras out to the back of the boat and you guys can follow along as we park this thing, because very soon we're going to operate the wing station. So I'll set this up here. Get you another angle just here. Hopefully this works. Yep. I'll grab that bow line on the way in, get it to this forward midships cleat.
I'll get it in, I'll get that stern line on, then we'll be right.
Yeah, no worries.
Okay. Is that camera ready?
Yeah, we're on. We're okay. Filming.
So now I've activated the starboard aft wing station.
Yep.
And again, just selected the dock assist function on this boat. And just backing the boat in, getting myself parallel with the jetty. This is a tight berth that we've got here. I've got I can see down the entire waterline length of the vessel, and I'm nice and parallel where I am. So I'm just gonna bring it back meter at a time. As we're going through now.
Hope you enjoyed that, guys. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoy this content. Riviera 585 SUV, rugged, practical. It's a ute of the ocean. SUV, sports utility, it really is correct in that terminology. And my biggest takeaway from today is the new upgraded joystick technology, that dock assist holding us in the marina steady. It was almost millimeter accuracy, and we had no qualms of leaving the helm and sorting out the fenders and the lines with the boat in the middle of the marina and a crosswind blowing. That was incredible. That means this boat is possible to operate really short-handed. So if you thought you were going to struggle going over, say, your 40 to 50 footer that you've got now, and you were worried moving up to something 58 feet length on the waterline and 65 feet overall, don't worry. Don't worry at all. Who's it compete with? Well, not many boats, to be fair, because the quality on this thing is in a class of its own. I can only think of one brand that I've tested in America, which is Sabre Yachts, which comes close. Everything else just doesn't compete. And the Australianized way of thinking, is that a word, Australianized? The Australian thinking, which has clearly gone into this boat, still makes it stand out on its own because it's so practical. Guys, I will put up a link to some of the competing boats on the screen right now. Have a look if you're interested. My name's Dan Jones. You've been watching Dan's Boat Life. Thanks very much. I'll see you on the next one.